even know what time zone is in. Seriously.
Who are you?
I am from the Anglophile channel.
Los
Thank
Angeles.
You so much.
Good.
He never remembers my name. This is really hurtful.
Marlise Boland.
Oh, God, you got it right this time. Okay, good for you. Points. Okay, so tell me. Okay, you've been asked this 100,000 times, but I want to know. This is the end of the journey. So what was it like to see the film all completed and knowing that this is the end and tomorrow night and what sort of emotions are going to be running through you?
It's actually it's the hardest thing I find to watch my own work back. Mm. And I tend to watch myself through my hands. To see everyone else's work was amazing. Seeing it in IMAX, high frame rate, 3D, Dolby Atmos sound. I've never sat in a theater and felt so moved and rocked by an image. It's so spectacular. And seeing it in a theater full of people that feel the same, and I expected a vocalization, but people just leant forward and had their mouths open. So Pete has done exactly what he set out to achieve. He really pushed the boundary of cinema. He hasn't seen it in IMAX.
Oh, he hasn't?
No, because I said afterwards, did you see the IMAX? And he was in the different cinema to us. He was in the Odeon, so he hasn't seen his own movie yet.
And tomorrow night's not going to be in it?
Yes, it is.
Oh, it is? Yes. Oh, I'm looking forward to that. Okay.
Yeah. And it's in the Dolby Theatre, so I'm figuring the sound's going to be pretty good.
Okay. Exciting.
But yeah, I mean, end of the road and the final piece of the jigsaw puzzle. Very, very proud to have been part of the journey. And seeing Pete accept his star on the Walk of Fame today.
Which you were part of.
And seeing his family there and everyone around him after, I don't know, 15, 17 years of working
on this. Nearly two decades to celebrate.
Talking to his kids, you know, his children who are young adults now, and thinking that they haven't known that it's been there throughout their entire lives that he's dedicated his work to Tolkien. And so that's what tomorrow will be about. It's a big celebration and a big farewell.
Mm-hmm. That's amazing.
In the best way.
Exactly. Are you sad? Will you be sad?
I will be sad, but I won't be sad to be asked, how do they make you look so small?
I'm going to ask you that because now we're on the red carpet. So
I'm asking myself.
Okay, moving on to your future.
Yes.
Richard, we want to know about your future. You've had quite the year. You've really had an amazing year with Into the Storm and then The Crucible, which we saw. And
it was... Thank you very much for coming.
It was... You were spellbinding, you were heart-wrenching. It was an astounding performance, you know.
Thank you.
And the fans wanted me to write a review on it. And when something moves me like that, I feel like I can't write about it. I absolutely could. I would sit down and begin to write. I didn't have enough adjectives to describe it. It was so moving. The whole performance, the production was just incredible. You know, I know that story, and I've always loved Arthur Miller. I think it's Arthur Miller's best play. And, you know, so I was just astounded by it. And you mentioned that you threw up a lot during the scene, which you do.
Only on two occasions.
Oh, okay. Because you mentioned that you did that during The Hobbit as well. Is that a problem?
The thing on The Hobbit was that I was taking, like, a lot of sports drinks during that final fight because I had... just sustaining the energy and sweating, and so I was downing loads of sports drinks, and it was just coming up as quick as I could put it down. that's nice, isn't it?
Okay.
But on The Crucible, you really can't stop and take a sip of water, and there were times when, in the rehearsal room, I put water in all four corners of the room, and I would be reaching and grabbing it and thinking, I can't be doing this in performance, so you've got to find a way to sort of do this, to deal with it, to keep yourself hydrated. But again, it was like stamina building, like training for a marathon.
Exactly.
But what you said about the play, I remember feeling like that 20 years ago when I read the play. And in the rehearsal room when we first read the play, there was a section of the script that I remember connected with me so acutely 20 years ago. And I still couldn't say the words. They'd still choke me to say them.
Really?
And every night during the play, when that moment would come, it would just... I don't know, it's like, it's the moment when you realize that you're an actor. Because
exactly, it's theater just, magic.
Yeah,
it's
magic. It makes you vibrate, and the audience feels it too. Mm-hmm. And it's not something you can measure, or it's sort of the bit that happens between the writer and mm-hmm. the actor channeling it, and it's sort of somewhere in midair between you and the audience, and they catch it. It's really nice.
We could tell as the audience, you were absolutely immersed in the role. you know, oftentimes you'll go to see a play on the West End that's featuring a famous name, and all you can't get past that it's, you know,
right.
So, whoever it is. And the true art for me is to see a play where the actor immerses himself so completely that you're not thinking, oh my God, that's the movie star from this such and such movie. And you were able to do that. It's so beautiful.
Thank you. I mean, I'm an ensemble player. I know it. I'm not a big entertainer, and I'm not somebody that likes to put their head above the parapet above everybody else. Apart from the scene in The Hobbit where Thorin puts his head above the parapet. Except for that bit. But yeah, it feels very alien to me, and I feel that that's why the play worked, and that's what Yael Farber as a director was really interested in, is creating a kind of ensemble that really built this world together. And you know, Proctor was just a cog in that wheel. So yeah, I think that's why it worked for me.
So I mean, you do so much so well. You've had success in film. You've had incredible success on the stage. You've done two independent films this year. So what do you have a favorite? Do you favor one over the other, film, television?
It was interesting going back to theatre this year because I'd forgotten where I'd come from, and you know, I'd gone into doing television because it would help me get better roles on stage, and I forgot. I sort of kept going, and you know, once you get on that role, that's what happens. So it was a really good year for me to go right back to my roots, realize why I was so passionate about it, and actually doing some movies which were the antithesis of The Hobbit. You know, very simple, low budget, no CGI, just character driven stuff. So yeah, I feel quite fulfilled actually.
I noticed that. I noticed that your choices this year were independent fare. I mean, looking at you, seeing you in the Crucible, clearly you're an actor that should win Oscars. I mean, brilliant talent that we haven't seen in generations, I think. And you know, the fact that you've been part of blockbuster films. So you clearly can have a big A-list movie, but it seems like you shy away from that. Is that intentional?
I don't shy away from it. It shies away from me.
That can't be possible.
I feel like my career's always been a slow burn. I'm a slow developer. I went to drama school very late. I'm not an impatient person. I'm very, very patient. And actually, I'd rather have it when it's right than too soon.
Mm-hmm.
And as long as I'm fulfilled and it's inspiring me, I'm very happy.
The thing I love about British actors is they do go back to their theater roots, and they'll stop in the middle of, you know, a fast moving train, you know, of A-list movies to go back and do plays.
Yeah.
And I admire
that. It took me 13 years, but yeah, you're right.
Eventually they go. Okay,
I
so did.
I needed to be hit around the head with a sledgehammer to do it. But no, it's weird. We were looking for a long, long time, but it wasn't until it was that play in that theater, in that configuration with that particular director that we all just went, this is a no-brainer.
Mm-hmm.
And we haven't had that moment before. There's always been something about it that we're like, no, it's not sure. I'm not
so you
sure
didn't want to play The Engineer in Miss Saigon or Les Mis?
I don't think you're ever going to see me in a musical again.
You got a good voice.
I really don't. The opportunities come along, and I just think there's so many other things I think I'd prefer to do before I do that. Just give me one second. I'm just over here checking out Richard II or whatever it's going to be.
So no tights?
Not in the near future, no.
All right.
But Yael and I are going to collaborate again.
Oh, yes, good. In New York?
Hopefully. But that's not a main criteria. It could be anywhere on the planet, but we're definitely going to do something together.
Lovely. I was watching your Twitter tour, and they received you in Brazil like you were Elvis. I mean, Elvis is in the house.
I know.
What was that like?
It's weird because I look behind me and go, what? What? I don't. It's it's not me.
Tall,
it's not
dark,
really
swarthy
me.
Guy.
It's their passion for the movies, and they're very, very expressive. You know, it's something I came back from Brazil with. Was like, you know what? Show your emotions. Show how happy and excited you are, because we get very kind of reserved and try and be blasé and take it all in our stride, but
yes.
They don't.
They show you
how they feel. And
they have a zest for life.
I want to say it felt good.
And so do the Italians. You know, there was a whole group of Italian fans that were putting together a campaign to have a Hobbit premiere in Italy.
I feel so bad that we weren't able to go. Because
I felt awful.
In the back of my head, I was just thinking, yeah, Rome. Do a premiere in Rome.
Exactly.
How cool would that be?
A gondola in Venice,
yeah.
You know,
the arrivals would
Florence.
Be quite tricky in Venice, wouldn't it?
Yeah, it would be fun, though.
Arriving by gondola.
pay some money to see Thorin and Gandalf on it.
Stumbling and falling into the water.
It would have been beautiful. But yeah, they had a whole campaign going.
Sorry, guys. Oh. Sorry, Italy. We've lost them.
Was there a question you wish they asked, but they didn't?
No. Okay. They asked everything. They were very, very comprehensive.
I know. That's why I thought, you know, today, they've already heard everything there is to know about The Hobbit, the
Do
process.
You think you have one question that no one would have asked?
Yeah, Thorin, boxers or briefs?
Neither.
That's why we love him. Okay, you know that's going to become a GIF, right? You know what that is? Where they pull like a sound bite off of what something you've said. Mm. Yeah, and it becomes their telephone ring.
It's the truth.
Neither. If you could have played any character other than Thorin in the Hobbit or Lord of the Ring movies, who would you have played?
Can I have two?
Okay.
I'd love to know what it feels like to be Gandalf. Mm. I'd love to have all that wisdom and all that kind of naughtiness, which it's the one thing that I love about Ian's performance, is that he could have played the wizard, but he brings a whole lorry load of Ian McKellen naughtiness and feeds it through the character. And it's something that Pete just loves about the character. When Gandalf's being naughty or cheeky, he loves it. So yeah, that or Gollum.
And is he naughty on the set?
Very, very naughty. He notoriously lifted his gowns and did a can-can on a number of occasions, yeah.
What did he have in his gowns?
You slipped that one in, like, really casually, and again, that stays in New Zealand.
Okay.
And the other character would be Gollum. I think Gollum is one of Tolkien's, literature's greatest character creations. It's my favourite scene from the book, Riddles in the Dark.
Mm.
And it's one of the scenes that you forget about when you watch the first Hobbit movie. You think, oh, of course, right. Riddles in the Dark. Again, you know, immortalised by Andy Serkis.
Andy Serkis does an amazing, amazing job.
And look at Andy's career now. From the seed of that character, he has the
created
most
a whole nother. Yeah. And what I liked about, he said something on the red carpet recently about someone asking if it should be a separate category for award nominations.
I think
it
should.
And he said, it shouldn't, because it's acting.
Oh, I see what you're saying. Yeah, it's not digital.
It should be considered another acting performance.
I agree.
Absolutely right. Because he said it's acting, you're creating a character.
Yeah, completely. I agree with him.
Where do you keep your sword? The orc
My
crest.
Sword.
Get your minds out of the gutter.
In the umbrella stand.
Really? You don't? By the door?
Yeah, just in case there's an intruder. They're not getting past the doorstep.
What was the highlight of your year? Was it winning the Favorite British Artist of the Year award for the Angkor channel?
God, was that this year?
It was this year. Your reign is almost over, by the way. There's going to be
Do I have to give that thing back?
You know, do you still have it?
Of course I do. Okay. That's with the sword. That was the original
is
weapon.
Is it next to the sword?
Yes.
Because
if the sword fails, I can use that piece of glass to...
It's crystal.
Crystal.
Excuse me. Well, kind of like Miss America, I think you're going to have to pass it down to the winner.
Okay.
No, really. What was the highlight of your year?
The highlight of my year was the opening night of The Crucible. I try to stray away from any kind of self-serving sentiments, but it's an amazing feeling when an audience gets to their feet. And we had no idea, we had no concept that the play was going to work, whether people were going to like it. So that night will stay with me for a long time.
And that's why theater is best, because you get the immediate reaction that you don't get from films.
Yep.
You know, and it's beautiful. I love theater. It's magic. So it wouldn't be an Anglophile Channel interview if I didn't give you your Christmas present. See, last time I gave
Please
you...
Please tell me it's not Thorin.
It is Thorin.
Is it?
And he always looks pissed off.
He's very angry. Is there not a thank you? Can I...
It's a box of joy, which, you know...
Thorin's box of
he's
joy.
He's a box of joy.
Sounds a bit rude. Are there other characters that you can keep safe?
I don't know, because, you know, I'm a Richard Armitage.
Why would you put Thorin on your Christmas? It's not even sparkly.
I don't know. Well, you can add glitter to it if you want to.
Is this an American thing?
It?
Because, like, you guys dress for Halloween, which is supposed to be witches and wizards, you dress up as everything.
Yes, we do.
Okay.
Yes. So it's a Hallmark ornament. Hallmark is a greeting card.
They've done a good job of that, haven't they? Look.
There he goes. Oh, he's got the orcris.
He's even got... He's got like a weird thing on his head. Oh, that's so you can
hang
him on the tree.
That's you put the little hanger there.
Merry Christmas, one and all.
There you go. Excellent.
Where's yours? And we can have a little fight.
I know. I should. I beat you.
Thank you very much.
All right. Thank you so much for talking to us.
Nice to see you. Mwah. See you on the red carpet.
See you on the red carpet.